Aze Maohana, Aloha Kakahiaka, this is Kawazi, and I wanted to read something precious to us through the Psalms. Psalms 136, verse 1 and 3 says, "Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, for his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his steadfast love endures forever." Thank God that he is steadfast and that his love for us endures forever. Despite our sins, despite what we have done, God is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins. And if you affirm that with me, say hallelujah. Amen, amen. Wanted to encourage you guys today that we're about to worship. And we believe at Ohana Church that worship is more than just song, but worship is a lifestyle. So a lifestyle of the scriptures. And so one of the ways we're going to celebrate this is through songs, also through prayer, also through giving. Today you can give to one of the three platforms right below on this screen. Would you live generously in the name of Christ? Another way we're going to worship is through the preaching of God's word. I want you to be attentive. Ho'olohe, my mom would say. Zee, ho'olohe. Listen up. Listen to the words that are going to be shared today through the text of scripture. We know this, that a preacher does not make the gospel powerful, right? The gospel makes the preaching powerful. So listen to those words. Take notes. We have notes for you at the Bible app, as we've shared for the last few weeks. Another way we're going to worship is by response. We're going to respond today in how God is calling us individually and as a family to respond to the text and our sermon today. Lastly, we're going to worship 12 p.m. today by gathering via Zoom to go over the plans for the next week as we open up our doors for public worship gatherings here at 1967 Kinole Street. How many of you are pumped and jacked about meeting together physically? Like, you know, like I said earlier on the video this week, if your family is not ready or you're not ready to come physically, that's fine. We'll have an online platform, and we've decided to make that online platform, excuse me, my pigeon is coming out, right? And we're gonna make that online platform Facebook. So if you don't have a Facebook account, get a Facebook account. It's free, all right? If you do have an account and you have Roku or Fire Stick or Apple TV or whatever kind of those devices, those fancy devices, you can download the Facebook app and watch service on there. Then later on, we will upload all our recorded services following that live service on YouTube for anyone who has missed the live feed on Facebook. Man, we're excited, right? Again, worship is more than just emotional expressions of music and all that. Worship is a lifestyle, and it's a lifestyle rooted in scripture. So if you understand that God's love is steadfast and it endures forever, would you give me a big amen in Jesus? Amen. Have a blessed day in the Lord. See you guys at 12 o'clock as well.
Aloha kakahi ako, ohana. Welcome and thank you for joining us today. Please grab your ohana and let's worship God together and lift our voices of praise.
We need no other hiding place. Hope is safe within your name. This we know. This we know. You promise never to forsake. What you began, you will sustain. This we know. This we know.
Strong.
confess your sins to Jesus? Jesus is righteous, and He can cleanse you of all your unrighteousness. Just confess everything to Him. Let's sing this together. I need You to soften my heart, break me apart. I need You to open my eyes, to see that You're shaping my life. All I am, I serve. Trust what You say, that You're good and Your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give You my life. Oh. I need You soften my heart, soften my heart, break me apart. I need You to pierce through the dark and cleanse every part of me. All I am, I trust what You say, that You're good and Your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give You my life. I may be weak, Your Spirit's strong. Trust what You say, that You're good, Your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give You my love. Give me faith to trust what Lord, want to thank You for letting us pray to You, God, and confess our sins to You. And like 1 John 1:9 says, You are righteous and just to forgive us of all our unrighteousness. To forgive us of all our unrighteousness because You are righteous, Jesus. Thank You for being our Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
My name is James Sharoma. I'm the lead pastor of The Gathering. We have two campuses, one in Mililani and the other in Honolulu. I'm married to Julie Sharoma, and we have a 7-year-old daughter, Sadie. And we are so glad to be out here in Mililani and Honolulu. We have a vision not only to impact our island and state, but to impact the world. At The Gathering, we're very passionate about building leaders because we believe that what we do today matters. And so every person who we believe God is going to use or desires to use for his kingdom purpose as a leader, we pour into intentionally. We believe that it is very important for us to focus everything that we do on gospel, to focus on Jesus, and to teach through the truth of the Word of God. We don't move away from that. Jesus is primary, the gospel is central, and we want to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. We believe that not only for our church, but for all the churches start here in Hawaii and throughout the world, this needs to be the model. We can't step outside of this. We move outside of this. I believe that we can move into areas where maybe dangerous, but where there's power is through the gospel, through Christ, through the Spirit, through His Word. And those are the churches and leaders we want to build up. We want to thank all of you for being part of this great plan that God has for all of us to partner together to reach Hawaii, America, and the world for Jesus. Thank you so much.
How the scripture says that His mercies are new every morning. And I thank the Lord for that, that His mercies are new every morning. And today we're going to declare His words because He is great and He is faithful. So sing this song with me. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness. So blind and unfailing, covenant promises tell not to me. Then without warning, desire, or deserving, I found my treasure, my pleasure in Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord. This third verse says, I have no merit. I cannot save myself. But because of Jesus Christ, He is the one who saves us, church. So I want you guys to sing this song out with me, this verse out.
I have no merit to woo or delight Thee. I have no wisdom or powers to employ. Yet in Thy mercy how pleasing Thou find'st me. This is Thy pleasure, that Thou art my joy.
And this verse goes, pardon for sin and the peace that endureth. God, Jesus has pardoned our sin, and he has given us great joy because of him. So let us sing that song together. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and a bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness. Sing it out. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. Oh,
if you have your Bibles, and I hope you do, would you turn to the Gospel of Mark? And would you stand with me in the reading of this beautiful text? As we wrap up our series today in the Gospel of Mark, I want you to hear these words with a heart of gratitude, but also with a heart of urgency. I want you to hear these words that Mark pens in this account with a heart of gratitude and a heart of urgency. So you're standing right now. Ho'omaukaukau. Aye. Let's read the Word of God. Chapter 10, starting in verse 46 of the Gospel of Mark. Mark pens this, that, and they came to Jericho. And as he was leaving Jericho with his disciples and a great crowd, Bartimaeus, a blind beggar, the son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent, but he cried out the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up. Jesus is calling you. And throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? And the blind man Bartimaeus said to him, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. And Jesus said to him, go your way. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed him on the way. Lord Jesus, we confess today that apart from you, we cannot do nothing. And Lord, as we read this text, we ask you for a few things. Number one, give us clarity, God. Help us to understand these verses. Secondly, God, give us conviction. Convict our hearts for what you proclaim in this text. And lastly, Lord, give us compassion. Help us to have compassion for those who are hearing and listening and watching every move we are making. As your followers, help us to honor you and exalt you alone. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, God's Ohana says, Amen. Amen. Nohoi lalo, you may be seated, right? This story has a lot to do with a tension that either we have forgotten or we have no clue about. And it's this, it's our response to our need for Jesus. Like, are you desperate for Jesus today? As you evaluate your walk with Christ, those who say, I am a follower of Christ, I know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. Are you desperate for Jesus? Does your life reflect that you have met with Jesus? Does your life reflect that you know Jesus? Does your life reflect that you have spent some critical, crucial minutes, moments, and hours spending time with the Savior of the world? Are you desperate for the Holy King? And the reality is, as we become followers of Christ, there is a tension where we sometimes draw away from our fellowship with Him. And when we draw away from our fellowship with Him and our time spent with Him, it is tempting to no longer be desperate for the Savior of the world. And I believe there's a few fallacies that we have to address that is not true, but we submit to because of sin. Remember, we say it all the time. Though as followers of Christ, though we are free from the penalty of sin, we are still affected by it every single day. That's why we said in a few messages ago that as we follow Christ, He commissions us in three ways, right? To deny ourselves, right? To take up our cross and follow Him. That is true. Denying ourselves is a posture of surrender, a posture of total desperation for the one who deserves our attention, our affection, our gratitude, our praise. That's Jesus. Are you desperate for Jesus? Or are you desperate for things that are created? Are you worshiping the creation rather than the Creator? I am guilty. My hands is raised. I've gone through season. I'm going through a season right now, what I would call a drought, where it feels like I'm just going through the motions of being a follower of Christ, right? One who's a pastor, a kahu, right? One who's looked after for manao. I go through those seasons. I'm going through it right now. I want to be just transparent. And what God does, He continually uses His word to sharpen us and to draw us back to intimate fellowship with Him. Hallelujah. What a Savior, right? And so here's three fallacies I want us to see on why we're not desperate for Christ. Number one, we have become divisive with our theology. We have misused Scripture to abuse and to put down. But Paul, the apostle of Christ, who wrote most of the New Testament, always says that Scripture exists to build up one another, right? We have made our theology more about head knowledge than about ministering to hurting and broken people. And listen to me, the gospel, theology, doctrine, it matters, right? It matters. But before it ministers to anyone else, be reminded, it ministers to us first, personally. Here's a second fallacy. We have become self-focused. We've forgotten about the Great Commission because we are consumed with ourselves. I've seen it all over social media, right? Right? People saying, man, I just need to worry about me. I just need to focus on myself. There's some truth to that, right? But I want to be very clear. It's not to make you a better you. As followers of Christ, we don't focus on ourselves to make a better self of us, right? We focus on our hearts so that our hearts can be changed by Jesus through the reading of the word, through prayer, through adorations, also through public gatherings, praise the Lord, as we get to experience starting next Sunday, right? That's what it means to focus on ourselves. Does our heart look like Jesus? Does our life look like Jesus? And as we focus on that, we're not trying to be better Jesus followers, right? We're submitting to the authority of Christ Himself. And what He does in us through submitting through Him is for the glory of His name. May we decrease so that the Son of Man, Jesus, may increase. And here's the last fallacy. We have become okay with just being okay. Some of you have used this COVID season to really take a long vacation. Rightly so for some of you, you had nothing else to do, but I pray that when we come out of this COVID season, that the examining question for all of us was, does our family look more like Jesus? Meaning, did we spend our time, our energy, our resources in investing in our lives, in the gospel? Some of you, you may like this season and you may never come back to church again, right? Because you're comfortable on how life is going. Let me tell you, nothing good comes out of comfortability. When we are comfortable, we don't grow, right? When we get comfortable, but when we are challenged, when adversity comes, right? God does what only He can do in those adversities, right? He conforms us to His image. He transforms us, right? And look at this. We have lost our need and desperation for our Savior. We may even go back to conversion when we were saved on that one Sunday or that one day, whatever day it was. It's that, well, I said my prayer, right? I've trusted in Jesus as my Savior. I did my part. I'm good. I'm sealed. No, that is not the gospel. That is not the gospel. The gospel is not determined by what you have done. It's not an event. The gospel is a process of God doing the work of God, transforming us from the inside out. We should never grow away from our desperate need for our Lord and our Savior. As followers of Christ, whether or not we are new or mature in the faith, our hearts should continue to break for our need for Jesus. Listen to some of these examples throughout Scripture of how some of these people showed their desperation for the Lord. The prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 6 says, Lord, I am unclean. I have filthy lips. Lord, cleanse me. This is what Isaiah said in chapter 6. You know, King David, after he sinned with Bathsheba, God took his first child from that relationship. And David confessed a prayer that was of repentance. He said, God, create in me a clean heart. And God, renew a right spirit within me. God, cast me not away from your presence, but restore unto me the joy of your salvation. I mean, that's what it means to be desperate for the Lord. The Apostle Paul said, wretched man that I am, who will save me from my bodily form? Do you hear that, words of desperation? And then the God-man, Jesus himself, he demonstrates in his priestly prayer before the cross in the Garden of Gethsemane, and he cries out to his Father. He says, if you are willing, take this cup from me. John also penned it in such a way in his account that he said that Jesus broke out with drops of sweat like blood. Are we desperate for Christ? Or are we desperate for our safety? Are we desperate for our comfortability? We're desperate for that once a month, twice a month paycheck. We're desperate for the friends and okay with them. We're desperate for everything else but God himself. I pray as we look at this text, we would be reminded by Romans 10, where it says, those who call on the name of the Lord will be, help me out, saved. This is not a text to be emotional for the sake of being emotional. My heart is broken for my own sin, my own heaven. My heart is broken for you who are watching.
My heart is broken for the families of Ohana Church. My heart is broken for those who lost their brother, their father this week due to a heinous crime. My heart is broken for the injustice of this world. My heart is broken for mankind and the history of sin because of depravity in the garden. My heart is broken, and all I can do is shout out to God that, God, I need you. I need you, God. I need you more than ever. Oh, I need you, God. I'm crying out to you, God, right now today that I need you. I'm not trying to get popularity points today, God. I need you. I need you. May we need God today. May we need God today. And as we look at our verses today, there's really two main thoughts that I want us to derive about crying out to God. Here's the first thought. Number one, our need for Christ is connected with our need for salvation. If you look at verse 46, it talks about a location, a familiar location if you've been a follower of Jesus or in the Gospels or Christian for a while. This location in Jericho, Mark pens that Jesus is actually doing his ministry in Jericho. This location is all throughout Scripture. In fact, in the Old Testament, Jericho was a place of pagan worship. It was a place where God's people conquered. You guys remember that story? Joshua fought the battle of Jericho. An old song we sang growing up in the church, in 7 days, they walked around Jericho, right? And the walls came tumbling down. And God's people wiped out Jericho. It was also a place after that battle that Joshua, the leader of Israel, right, cursed the grounds of Jericho. It was also a place where some prophets lived in, settled in, like Elijah and Elisha. It was a strategic location. It was the gateway to Palestine. It was the gateway to the promised land as Jesus communicated with Moses and the Israelites. But in the New Testament, Jericho was rebuilt by King Herod. Scholars say that it was a place of wealth and stability. Therefore, it was also a place filled with many beggars and people with ministry needs because of the wealth that was filled in this rebuilded city. And what happens as we move on in verse 46, Mark accounts of a blind man by the name of Bartimaeus. And here's the description of Bartimaeus by Mark's account. He was not just blind, but he was also a beggar. This is how he made a living. The Bible does not say much about his father, other than that Bartimaeus means out of this language that he is the son of Timaeus. And what the Bible says is that Bartimaeus was stationed right by the roadside of where people walked in and out of the city. You could say that Bartimaeus was a genuine panhandler of the day, right? Bartimaeus lived a life of disgust and humility because of his blindness, his physical blindness. But, right, thank God for this word, but Jesus comes on the scene, and the verse continues in verse 47, saying that, and when he heard, this is Bartimaeus, when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began, listen to me, to cry out and say, listen to me, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. Here's a critical question I want us to ask, right? And here's the question. How did Bartimaeus know about Jesus? Nowhere do we see Bartimaeus mentioned in the Gospel of Mark, but this one time, and we see him confessing big claims about Jesus. That Jesus was the Son of God, Son of David, and that he begged Jesus to have mercy on him. Now, Luke has a similar account, but like Mark, has no other mentioning of Bartimaeus in his book as well. So what's the answer? How did Bartimaeus know about Jesus? Here's the answer. Bartimaeus was a witness of Jesus' teaching and healing ministry in Jericho and all of Galilee. Bartimaeus was not the only blind person who was healed in Jericho. In fact, in Matthew 20, in his account, he accounts of two blind people, not just Bartimaeus. In Luke 18, he accounts of one blind man being healed while entering the city. And then Mark and Luke concurs that there is only one blind man. So the key to this passage is not so much how many blind men there were in there, right? I believe there were three based on these accounts. Because Jesus, the Gospel of John says there was many other miracles that Jesus did that was not accounted in our Gospels. So I believe there are many other blind people that were healed during this day. The key to this passage is that all accounts of the story confessed in Matthew, in Mark, and in Luke says the same terminology about who Jesus is. That he is the Son of God, meaning that he is the Son of David, meaning that he is the Messiah, the promised Messiah, that he has arrived, and that he would be the one, the only one that can have mercy on someone like Bartimaeus. And the tension, right, in this desperation, no cry, this kind of desperation is usually overseen and dismissed. Let me be very clear, right? This kind of tension of people in publicly just screaming for help, yelling for help, is usually overseen and dismissed. This is true for us this week in Minneapolis. When the man was on the ground, he was begging for help. He was begging for mercy. And it's true that only God, Jesus, can give mercy. And this is overseen and missed in the church today. Look at how the disciples treat Bartimaeus. In verse 48, it says, And many rebuked him, telling him to be silent. And I love what Bartimaeus does. Watch this. Listen to this, brothers and sisters. This is what he said. But he cried out all the more, Son of David, Jesus, have mercy on me. I want you to feel that. I want you to sense that. I want you to read into the lines. I want you to see this desperation cry. This man, Bartimaeus, as blind as he wasn't going to allow some other people to stop him from seeing Jesus. Right? It's interesting that the disciples tend to reject people who are lesser than them. Earlier on in this chapter, they dismissed the children from coming to Jesus. Someone lesser. Jesus rebukes them. Tell them, come on. Now they're dismissing a poor old blind beggar. Jesus tells them again, let him come to me. This should teach every one of us, right? That God calls the brokenhearted. God calls the lesser. God calls the one who is far from him. Why? Because he is a God of grace. He is a God of mercy. This is true for the church today. We tend to give attention to the things that are safe, that fits in our box, that's easy to control. And Jesus continues to demonstrate that his purpose in the gospel is to shed light on the unsafe things and chasms of our world. Wow. Wow. That is so precious. So gracious, so merciful our Savior is. And in verse 49 to 50, Jesus calls Bartimaeus to him. Bartimaeus, listen to me. He is crying out and Jesus responds. And Jesus drops the bomb. And you know what Jesus does? He says, you, the one that never let you come to me. You go to him and you tell him, come to me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for putting us Christians who've been following you for a while in our place. Us guys who've been walking with Christ for a while needs to be humbled. And Jesus does that just to his followers. Jesus uses, right, our foolishness for the glory of his name, right? We see Jesus, go get that brother. Tell him, come to me. And Bartimaeus responds by taking off his cloak. This is an outer garment, which is a sign of humility whenever Israelites would take off this garment. It's a sign of respect and reverence. And in his blindness, Bartimaeus, and in his brokenness, he came to Jesus. And we see the Savior of the world responds graciously to Bartimaeus. Verse 51 continues on and says that Jesus said to him, what do you want from me? And what do you want me to do for you? There is beauty in these words because the sovereign creator of the universe would request our need in this very passage. He gives Bartimaeus the platform to request to him his need. And this is the beauty of salvation, that we understand what our true need really is. And Bartimaeus replies, he says, Rabbi, let me recover my sight. Listen to me. The physical need was rooted in Bartimaeus' need for Jesus. I want you to see that. It was bigger than just physical sight, but it was a moment not to just experience physical healing, but to experience the healer himself, Jesus. It was a moment to experience the Son of David and the one who can grant mercy, Jesus. And Jesus wraps up this miracle. He didn't work hard to do this miracle, by the way. He did it the same way he created the heavens and the earth, with his breath. Jesus states to Bartimaeus, right? Look at verse 52. And Jesus said to him, go your way. Your faith has made you well. Beautiful Jesus. Beautiful Savior. And there's controversy in this verse, specifically with the word faith. I want you to see that faith has always been explained in Scripture historically and hermeneutically in one specific way. And the best way I can describe it is to share it to you through a strong concordance that I affirm. It says here that faith is always a gift from God and never something that can be produced by people. In short, the Greek word pistis, faith, for the believer is God's divine persuasion. And therefore, distinct from human belief, confidence, yet involving it, the Lord continuously births faith in the yielded believer so they can know what Christ prefers, the persuasion of Jesus' will. We live in a day and age, I want to address it again, where the prosperity gospel and the word faith movement has caused us to look at faith as something that we possess in and of ourselves. Listen to me. Faith is not something we are born with, right? That's what the Strong Concordance says. Historically, hermeneutically, faith has always been God's gift to us. In fact, Ephesians 2, 8 to 9 says this, for by grace you have been saved through what? Faith. Keep reading on. And it is not your doing. It is what? The gift of God, right? Not a result of works, so that no one may boast. But I grew up in a denomination that said if somebody did not get healed, they did not have enough faith. And they will use this passage to say, Jesus said you were healed by your faith, right? So we do have a faith to operate in. And I believe faith, we do have a faith to operate in, but the definition of faith has never been something that we possess in and of ourselves. Jesus gave it to us at the moment of salvation. Are you with me today? Do you understand? Because I promise you, there's churches this morning in our city, in our town, in our islands that will use faith as a works-based salvation, that we have faith in it of ourselves. No, faith is given to us by God. Why? So that nobody would proclaim that they saved themselves. That's exactly what the text is saying. When Jesus said, your faith has healed you, Jesus is connecting the dots with ownership. Now that I've given you this gift, here's your stewardship. Here's how you manage it. Here's how you own it. How do you do it? Trust in me. This is how the Lord Jesus persuades us, because there's nothing else good in us that we would want. For Bartimaeus, and he gets more than sight, he gets faith in the one who gives him vision. Jesus, hallelujah, right? That's what he's done. God is good to us, even when we are not good to him. So I want to wrap up our message today with the final thought. And our final thought is that our need for Christ is expressed through our dependence on him. Our verse ends in verse 52. And immediately Bartimaeus received his sight and followed Jesus on the way. When it comes to following Christ, remember these words. Remember, we still need him. Every moment, every second, every minute, at all times, we need him. And this is lived out through scriptural reading and exhortation, through prayer and through adoration. This is the result of salvation, not the means for salvation. The means for salvation is Jesus himself. The result of salvation, right, is that we would be people dependent on King Jesus. So here's a reality truth for all of us to embrace. Everything that Christ displayed in his humanity, right? He has graciously handed off to us in confidence that those who are blind will see. And the spiritual illustration to this story is that every one of us are living day Bartimaeus. We are all blind. We're all blind in need of Christ. And he gives us salvation in his name. That's why grace is so amazing. For those of you who are struggling in your walk with Christ, I want to share something to encourage you from Pastor Steve Lawson. He says this, that remember when you were on fire for God? Remember when you were zealous and passionate? Remember when you were actively witnessing? When you used to cry? When you used to rejoice? When you sung? Return to those days. Be more zealous for God. If you don't know God today, like Bartimaeus, would you ask God to take your blindness away and receive truth? If you are a follower of Christ, would you ask God the words that David confessed in the Psalms? Restore unto me the joy of my salvation. And this is how we should respond today. You guys ready? Follow Jesus. Follow Jesus. Do it in these three ways as we see in our text today. Cry out to God daily. This is looked like through prayer, through scripture reading, through songs of adoration and praise and meditation. Cry out to God daily. Secondly, have faith in him. The gift God has given you, faith, right? Trust him, believe him, honor him, bless him. Remind him that you are thankful for his salvation. And lastly, do not store what God has blessed you with, but encourage others in the same way. Build them up. Build them up in the faith. Would you pray with me and thank God for his goodness? God, we love you. We pray that those who have heard the word today would respond by faith, whether for conversion, salvation, or sanctification, salvation. Lord, that you would remind us that salvation is in your name alone. God, we need you. We're desperate for you. Let this message be a springboard to always be focused and desperate for you, Jesus. Would you renew our hearts? Would you renew our family, Ohana Church? As we come out of this COVID-19, as we begin to gather again publicly, help us to remember the glorious news of the gospel, that you have saved us from sin and death. You've rescued us in yourself. And by the power of your Spirit, you are moving us forward in the gospel. May people see our risen King, Jesus, through what we do, what we say, what we share. And God's Ohana says, Amen. If today you have been affected by the gospel, there's a few ways that you can respond in addition to what we just did. Number one, if you have no local church to come alongside of, to minister with, or to be ministered by, we believe every true believer has to be connected to a gospel preaching church. We would love for that church to be Ohana. We'd love you to be a part of our home, Ohana. Our priorities are simple, right? The gospel, the family, the mission. And that is expressed as we gather, grow, and go together. And so our mission is to love people to the beauty of Christ. So we want to encourage you and we want to love you in that vein. Secondly, if you are a member of Ohana Church, we believe that every true follower of Jesus has a role in the body of Christ. In just a few, in an hour or so, we're going to meet on Zoom. And on Zoom, we're going to, right, here's the numbers and the link below on how you can get connected on Zoom today at 12 o'clock Hawaii Standard Time. We want you to get connected, and we want to share with you how you can be prepared and how you can serve moving forward as we open up for this public worship gathering. I'm excited for that. I hope you are excited too. And again, if you cannot be a part of it, if you're not ready for it, we will have an online platform for you to continue to be a part of our worship gatherings. Hey, thank you so much for listening and hearing God's word today. Hope you're inspired and encouraged. If there's any way we can serve you, please contact us at the church office. We love you. We hope.